never grieve over the inevitable. From the layman's standpoint, he says, why grieve over the inevitable? Inevitable means it has an independent function, independent of your preferences, independent of your likes and dislikes. That's what is meant by inevitable. Inevitable doesn't mean, so I have to suffer, therefore I am suffering. Inevitable, not in that sense. Not inevitable like that. What it actually means is the inevitable about the inevitable about the facts. What is the fact? Events, situations happen, exist independent of your preferences, likes and dislikes. That's what is meant by calling it as inevitable. Oh, I have to suffer a loss, therefore I suffer. No, sir. I have to go through this, therefore I am going through. No. Inevitable, not in that sense. Inevitable means there is a totality, there is a functioning of life which happens all by itself, whether you accept it or not, whether you like it or not. In that sense, it is called inevitable. And why grieve? Why suffer over that? Why grieve over that? Because the grief is because you projecting your likes and dislikes upon. The grief is because you put up your the grief is because you put up your conditions. It should happen.
Therefore, the inevitable is that which functions independent of your likes and dislikes, independent of your preferences. It exists. Grieving implies you are not prepared for it. Grieving implies you are not ready for it. That's what grief implies. A lack of preparation. What is the lack of preparation? Independent of my preferences, independent of my likes and dislikes, things continue to go on. It is futile to have an independent. It is futile to have an independent likes and dislikes. Why it is futile is because. Why it is futile? It's futile because none is going to function. The nature is not going to function according to your likes and dislikes. The being around you is not going to function according to your likes and dislikes. You sit in grief. That's all. Therefore, he says, why grieve over the inevitable? There's no need to grieve. And you grieve because of the grief is because you do not accept it as, you do not see it as inevitable. How do you understand that? Right assessment. That's what he says. You experience grief not because of external factors, but because of your own unpreparedness. When you are not prepared, there is an unending hopes and expectations. And what preparation means? The preparation is nothing but an understanding. What is that understanding? Where there is an entrance, there is going to be an exit. That's all preparations. Where there is a beginning, there is going to be an end. It happens to life, it happens to relationships, it happens to everything. It comes, stays, and leaves. It has to leave. If it is not leaving, then there is something. There is something wrong. It has to leave. So the grief is not so much about death. In fact, if you carefully analyze, someone's death causing grief versus the life situation causing grief. Death doesn't cause that much grief, comparatively speaking. For all practical purposes, death doesn't cause that much grief, the physical death. What he means is the physical death, as much as other things. The other things causes more grief. What are the other things? The inability to face the people, face the environment, face the situations around you. That causes more grief than actual death. Sometimes we wish, but death in a once and for all, it is a finished itself. This is much more torturous than this is more torturous than death itself. So actually it is not death that causes grief. What causes grief is the environment, the situation, the people around you that you do not know how to handle first. You can't handle. They will handle themselves. You can't handle. All that you can do is what? Develop an understanding. All that you can do is to develop an understanding. What is that understanding? A right evaluation. A right assessment. That right evaluation, that right assessment takes away the demands. Takes away the expectations. If it is not there, there is an unreasonable expectation. And there is no such thing called reasonable expectation. Expectation only unreasonable. Expectation itself means it is unreasonable. A perfect understanding of what life is. A perfect understanding, a perfect assessment, a perfect evaluation, a perfect judgment. Very difficult is to do this assessment because you do not want to face the reality. You will be happy continuing with your imagination. You will be happy continuing with your dreams. You will be happy continuing with your hopes and expectations. But the little fundamental effort to understand will not happen. So actually grief is because of you not doing this effort. Able to follow now? The grief, actual grief is because of you not willing to make this effort. What is the effort? The effort to assess. The effort to evaluate. The assessment, the evaluation tells you one thing. What? When you rightly assess, when you rightly evaluate, what do you understand? You will not criticize, you will not judge, you will not become bitter. What do you understand? You will understand just as how helpless you are. Similarly, the other is also equally helpless. If you have to get frustrated at the helplessness of another, means you have to get frustrated at your own helplessness. That's all assessment. The person is all the time thinking words. The person talks. The words that he uses is very, very untrue. The words that the person uses is not very there. They don't know how to speak in the group. That person is, what do you understand? That person is helpless. Number one. Number two is, that person is not aware of it. Number three, that person is not making any effort to understand. You understand that, you will not be affected. Again I repeat, that person is helpless. You can't get frustrated at the helplessness of it. That's why frustration about any other human being is the most futile thing, the most useless thing to get frustrated at someone else. If you have to get frustrated at someone else, primarily you should get frustrated at your own self. Because as selfless as they are, you are also. You want that person to change. Are you willing to change for that person? No, no, sir, that mind is unreasonable. I am talking only the righteous thing. What they are talking is unrighteous. They are calling me to come for Dikko. I am calling them to come for Vedanta class. How can? Yeah, that's all. Are you able to understand this? No, my expectation is correct because my expectation has something holy in it. My expectation has something righteousness in it. And their expectation has something unrighteous in it. Example. Hey, 1 week I come for Vedanta class, now 1 week you should come for disco dance. Understand? I'm just giving an exaggerated example. Just as you are incapacitated to change, equally the other is too. Your standard of right and wrong, good and bad, you are bound by that. No one else is bound by that. Again, I repeat. You have a standard of right and wrong, you have a standard of good and bad. Except you, no one else is bound by that. If at all you expect them to follow. You follow that because of your understanding. And if the other person has not understood, how can you expect that person to follow? There's no grief. Are you able to follow what I'm saying? Yeah, I went very fast. Very simple. Just as you are helpless about your own self, the other is also equally helpless. Number one. Number two, whatsoever you do out of your understanding. You cannot transfer your understanding to another. Therefore, they will function according to their nature. That's all. They will function according to their nature, they will function according to their understanding. But I have an obligation, master. You will not leave the other aside. You have to somehow go on and bind yourself. No, but I have an obligation. No. What will I do? Then it means Vedanta also says you have to do your obligation. And the same Vedanta says there is a primary obligation that you have, that you don't hear only. Yeah. When that is said, you put all there's a shutter to the ears. You put that. Rest of the things you suddenly talk about obligation. Yeah. What is your primary obligation? And, ah, to reach the hell. That's all. Your primary obligation is. No, no, that I will do later, sir, but let me. Similarly, exactly in the same way, just as you have postponed that which you have to do, the other has also postponed. There is a difficulty. That's all you say. I'm not saying, Shankarshan. Engita Kuchkarimba. I'm only saying, he's only. என்ன புக்ல எழுதிருக்கிறாரோ அதை நான் ஒப்பிக்கிறேன் அவ்வளவுதான். ஐ எம் நாட் டூயிங் எனி திங் ஆஃப் மை ஓன். ஜஸ்ட் அஸ் யூ ஆர் போஸ்ட்போனிங் தட் விச் யூ ஹேவ் டு டு அட் திஸ் மொமெண்ட், த அதர் இஸ் ஆல்சோ போஸ்ட்போனிங். ஜஸ்ட் அஸ் யூ ஆர் ஹெல்ப்லெஸ் அபவுட் இட், த அதர் இஸ் ஆல்சோ ஹெல்ப்லெஸ் அபவுட் இட். வாட் இஸ் தேர் ஃபார் யூ டு, வாட் இஸ் தேர் ஃபார் யூ டு கிரீ, வாட் இஸ் தேர் ஃபார் யூ டு கெட் எஜுகேட்டட், பட் யூ ஆர் கெட்டிங் எஜுகேட்டட், யூ ஆர் இன் கிரீ பிகாஸ் wrong assessment. What is the wrong? Either no assessment or wrong assessment. What is that? Grief, chauffeur, arises only because of grief is nothing but disappointment. What is grief? Grief is nothing but disappointment. And what is disappointment? Expectations, na? But my expectations are reasonable, no, sir. Yajna bhotan kwaam nili bhotan na 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 kya kare? We are sleepless nights because it's really why expectations? So you understand that. Somewhere down the line, my demands, my expectations always look reasonable to me. Just as your demands, your expectations looks reasonable to you, it is to the other. You feel your demands are justified because you will give it a moral flavor to it. You will give it a moral coloring to it. I am saying not for my own self, sir. Milind, I don't want anything. I am only saying it for the moment you bring in the word, I am saying this or I am doing this only to the welfare of others, that will give you the whipping stick. That gives you the whipping stick where you can go on whipping the other. It's for your good only. It's for your good only. And the other turns around and says, who asked you? You get out. That's all. That you cannot handle. Therefore, that's what he says. See, the inevitable grief or the inevitable is not so much about the physical death. It's not so much about the physical death. It has got to do much about the environment and the situations that causes more grief than the physical situation. Because over a period of time, you get used to it. Or you can find some other interest and keep moving. Physical death doesn't cost that much. As much as the lack of assessment about the other cost. That's why he calls it as a layman's point of view. Up to 25, he spoke from the philosophical angle. Now he's talking from the layman's point. And layman's point of view seems more philosophical than? Yeah, correct, sir. Then I will know practically. First you should have spoken all this first. Philosophical thing look impractical and the layman's point looks more. What is this? Do not grieve over the inevitable. Do not be over the inevitable. It's the lack of preparation, the lack of expectation. Various examples you give, it becomes easy to understand. Every parent is desperate for their children to grow. And when they show signs of growth, and they show signs of growth, they are scared. They are worried. Lack of growth means what? growth means wings are grown and they are independent, they are independent, free. That's all it. Out of their choice, they must still stick to you. That is their problem. But the fact remains is they have become independent. That's all right. Assessment is, how can the mother accept the fact that the child has become independent? We cannot. On the one hand, the mother wants the child to grow, and when they show signs of growth, you cannot handle it. What is the sign of growth? What is the sign of growth? When do you know that they have grown up? Defy you, and they resist your condition. They will turn around, look at you and say, you don't know what you are doing, stay quiet. That's all. At what age they say that? 10. Correct. At 10, 11 they will turn around and say, you don't know what you are. At that point of time, if only you can turn back and say, this is what I told my mother, now you will have no problems. What you told your mother will forget. Yeah, that is forgotten. But then you want the child to, and if the child is not growing, you get, you will be desperate to do anything to make sure that the child grows, and then desperately you will make sure that the wings are also cut. On the one side you will make sure the wings develop. On the other side you will make sure that it is clipped out. This not knowing what you are doing causes grief. This not knowing what you are doing causes grief. You can go on and on and on giving examples to your own self. I am not giving examples. You start giving your own examples, it becomes easy. Do not grieve over the inevitable. Inevitable means there is a totality that is functioning independent of your life and its life. There is a totality that is functioning independent of your preferences, independent of your conditions, independent of your opinions about what is right, what is wrong, what is good, what is bad. Things function. Don't get agitated at it. Don't grieve over that. Why? Because even if they do that, they have no understanding. You are not doing it because you have an understanding. Gautama Buddha says, you know only one type of living. I know both, he says. I have lived like an ignorant man. I have lived like you, as an ignorant person in the past. I know that. And I know this also. He turns loving, he turns compassionate. He doesn't turn cruel, he doesn't take the whip and leave. Neither will he sit and grieve. Only when you understand your helplessness, you can be compassionate to the helplessness of another. The difficulty is, you think you are in perfect control. The difficulty is, you think you are in perfect control over yourself. You don't understand how helpless you are. One word here, one sight here, one perception here is enough to unsettle you. But you don't realize your helplessness. But then you don't understand it as helplessness, you justify it by calling it as, you will justify it using various, using various terms, various terminologies, you will justify it also. Nevertheless, it doesn't, nevertheless it doesn't work. Therefore, grief arises because of you not willing to put this fundamental effort. What is the fundamental effort? Self assessment. Lastly, carefully follow now. Only if you know how to assess yourself, you can assess the other. If you do not know how to assess yourself, you cannot assess the other. You will be criticizing, you will be judgmental in the name of assessment. If you do not know how to assess yourself, you can never assess others. That's where I started by saying, you understand your helplessness first, equally you will understand the helplessness of others. You understand how you don't have any control over your own self, other people has no control. You will be completely blind to the areas of where you don't have any control. And you can see very clearly the areas of others. Since it is so clear, you can easily pounce on it. Since it is so clear, you can easily pounce and tear them apart. And you have no justification also to do that. Therefore, he said, when you do not get what you demand, you are disappointed. Disappointment arises when your demands are not met. It's a demand, full stop. Any word you can use. And don't get carried away by the vocabulary that you use. Don't get carried away by the words that you use and blame yourself. At the end of it, the truth is, the reality is, it's your demand. And as long as you have a demand, you will be disappointed. And the demand is an expectation. The other should behave different from their nature, the other should behave according to yours. Understand? Yes. Demand and expectation is one and the same. What we ask is, how do you differentiate between demand and expectation? It is both are one and the same. Yes, demand is a much more stronger word to explain the truth. The expectation looks like, even though if it doesn't happen, you are okay with it. See, the word expectation doesn't have the force that the word demand has. In fact, both are one and the same. I demand, I insist. What is it that I demand? It is my child should follow. It is that my friend came home to wish Swati for her exams, because next week she is having board exams. So I will come and give her a few tips. I said, run and down. Yeah, if you don't come only, she is okay. Yeah, after this, people have given her enough tips. She has got already from everyone. And he is the principal of the school where we study. So, no, I will come with that. Okay, come. So, again, you know, first advice. Going to the exam, relaxed. Don't get tensed. She turned around and said, "Uncle, from 50 standard you can't just fear enough about the board exams. Board exams. And then on the day of exam, you are told, be relaxed. How is it possible? Is it possible?" Looked at me and said, "Unna madre train pandra." You are training that exactly like you. I said, "I don't know one arm partner because it, I said, he has picked up all the wrong things." Yeah, and I have only wrong thing now, what to do? Yeah, so it's a don't turn. Next. Which subject you like the most? He said, "Which subject I like the most, I don't know, uncle. But I can tell you that which I don't like." It is pretty much, I don't know, but I can tell you clearly that which I don't like. Which in the subject is mathematics I don't like. She said, "Mathematics I don't like." Arvindan's doctor, how can you say don't like mathematics? She turned around and said, "What has that got to do with?" That fellow, the background, right? He said that. When we were in 10th class, after the hostile exams got over, he came home crying because he was beaten up black and blue by the father. Because he failed. 10th hostile exam, he failed. The school called and said, "Unless you do something, you will not make the boy right to that board exam." And that's all I'm going to do. Don't get scared, don't get tense. Came home crying. My grandmother said, "Yeah, Madhu Lokan, I don't know. Go on. I know why he's crying. No, I can't tell this to my grandmother. You have been killing me, and I asked that to him, nothing." And he went and said, "You are going to go on the road, Mamma. Yeah, my life is tank Lokan, I'll be ready to go on the road." Yeah, you are attacking the tank, right? Nobody will. Now, what happened? They went and told the father, "Uncle Uttungo, somehow, I will make sure that he passes. How much mark you want that he should get?" Father saying, "I'm 50 mark at the record. When the fellow scored only 2 marks in half only, because 2 marks you scored half only, how can he win 50 marks at the record? What a charitable father he became. My ego, no, I have my own ego. Even today I have the ego. My ego said, 50 mark, I will make him score 70, uncle, don't worry. Adala mudiyadu, summa sollada, adala mudiyadu. No, I will do. Okay, I said, okay, da, see, you know, 10 chapters, you can leave 4 chapters on choice and still score 70. The system is like that, now what to do? Yeah, so we know how to? So I said, in the 4 chapters, we should. All the 4 mathematical chapters, yeah, calculus, arithmetic, trigonometry, then what mathematics are you building? Yeah, do all that and study only 3 months. 69 he scored, thank God. He scored 69. He is the math teacher in the school where we studied math and he failed also. I asked him, "Is not on bottom in Perry, man, in 10th level, I'm out of class there." I know that in the school, you know, whatever that he said. He said, "Everyone else has forgotten all the rest. Why did you only remember?" He is coming and saying, "The father is such a so good in mathematics. How can?" Yeah, expectation. What is that expectation? My daughter should have interest in mathematics. I studied Vedanta, it's my problem. Something went wrong in me, I studied this. Where should? No, but this is so good, no. Everyone should tell you no. That's your general love and affection you have for another. But that doesn't mean, that doesn't mean everyone. Correct. There is no grief. There is no grief. You follow? That's all. There is no grief. Otherwise, every step in life there is the grief. What is the grief? Demands not met. You have to be really egoistic. This is the philosophy. You have to be really egoistic. You have to be extremely selfish to demand. It is selfishness to demand. Egoistic to demand. The wise person says, this is the fact, do what you like. The wise one says, Do what you like. This is the fact. He will blow his lungs out trying to educate you on the fact. But it will never be enforced. It will never be forced. Understand? Even if you are genuinely interested in the welfare of the other, you should be able to inspire the other. Now, if you have to inspire the other, that much selfless you should become. No one is going to go by your logic and reason. No one is going to go by your explanations. Because just as you have your logic and reason, they have their logic and reason. And your logic and reason is so meaningless because you are bound by it, no one else is. You follow what I'm saying? Extremely selfish is to demand. And I want only do something. I don't know. How much have you done? How much, what you call as higher, how much have you done? Number two, how much are you following it? How much are you convinced about it? What you call as higher, how much are you convinced about it? Conviction means you will be effortlessly practicing it. That is conviction. What does conviction mean? If you are convinced, means you will be effortlessly living it. You will be effortlessly practicing it. That is conviction. If you yourself is not convinced, your primary obligation is to convince yourself. But the difficulty is, even before you are convinced, you will want to convince the other. That's why Ramakrishna says, lecture to yourself, don't lecture to others. Lecture to yourself, don't lecture to others. The demand itself is selfish by nature. The demand itself is highly egoistic by nature. And other rebels against you. You repel the other because of what? Instead of you inspiring the other, you repel. Why? Because of your demands. Again, I'm repeating, your demands might look reasonable to you. It's reasonable only to you. And you will try to enforce it on those who are. You will try to force your demand on whom? You will enforce it You will force it. On whom? On whom? Huh? Upon those who you think are dependent on you. Upon those whom you think are dependent on you. Who is dependent on you first? Yes? You think they are dependent on you?
Yeah.
So, first thing you enforce, you demand from where? From you? Huh? From you? Family, all of that. As a transcendent manali, almost enlightened. Hey, if you can see, almost you have attained moksha. After little bit of work done, easier moksha. But very difficult is to transcend, that is it. Because there is that built-in, there is that built-in ego, there is that built-in selfishness. You have not assessed your own self. You have not assessed how selfish you are and how helpless you are about it. When you understand your selfishness and how helpless you are about it, you will sympathize with the others. Even if you have outgrown it, you will not get agitated and frustrated about the others, because you know how much of hard work it takes to outgrow that. And you will be ready to help your mouth to do the hard work. Are you able to follow? That's where the assessment is. The starting point of assessment is from yourself, not from the. Vedanta has corrected us. My family is demanding so much from me. All of them have so much of expectation from me, sir. Vedanta is correct. Are you? Abhya unta all that? Yes. You have heard the you have heard the whole thing completely? Unta. Vedanta is saying, you are having that demand on them now. You hear it? They are having it on? What do I do, sir? Nothing you can say. What can you do? A lack of assessment. In that assessment, you turn twice. Even if you are genuinely interested in helping the other, temporarily leave the other for a while and you grow. But the difficulty is at the drop of a hat they are willing to postpone growth first. At the drop of the hat, we are ready to postpone growth for anything else. They also do. Therefore, Arjuna, there is no shoka. There is no grief. Yeah. Demand, expectation, both are. And what are? Artha verse, verse number 28.
Avyaktadi dibhutani yastamadhyani bharata avyaktani dhanadeva atrata paridevana
beings are unmanifest in their origin, manifest in their middle, unmanifest again in their end. Oh Bharata, what is there to breathe about? What is there to grieve about? Again, previous verse he spoke about assessment as a layman's point of view. Again, he is continuing. Another fantastic idea, another practical idea that he is giving. What is it? Unmanifest in their origin, manifest in the middle, again unmanifest in the end. Even there, what is there to give about? What is unmanifest means? Just take an example of any relationship that you have developed, any association. There was a point of time where that person wasn't there in your life. There was a point. The child is born when you are 30, let us say. There was a time where he wasn't there. In relation to that, you are not suffering or anything. You are continuing with life. Unmanifest in the beginning. Because of the sheer events of life, you just met, came together. That is manifest in the middle. Again, unmanifest in the end means. So that one thing I said, one day, it will go to na. What is there to grieve about? Are you able to follow? Assessment of the law in a Western world, because demand alone would have definitely I will have and demand, I will have expectations because I have determined to suffer na. Krishna will not leave you in suffering. So it is trying to give you another method. If that works, from a different angle, extraordinary. This verse is super from another angle. So wonderful the fact of life, he is saying. Beings are unmanifest in their origin, manifest in the middle, unmanifest in the end. So from unmanifestation to manifestation to unmanifest. From non-existence to existence to non-existence. Understand it like the way. It keeps going all the time. Even then, what is there to grieve about? Yeah. First week of my marriage, very scholarly I told this to Ranjini. After that I started talking philosophy to her. One and only time I spoke some philosophy, at the end of that, she said, she will laugh. Now she is laughing. Of course she didn't know what I was. After the first week after the marriage, when she said, no, I have to go on a tour. Yeah. After the tour, you have to go visit me. Relatives. And I like visiting relatives because nalla saapadu kekku. Otherwise they will ask you, why did you come? Yeah. For some bandha varagandu dana, they will ask. Yeah. Now only they will say, come. So, nice. Here we go. So, we are going to one place. I said, illa ma, we will go to that place, eat there, nalla saapadu lam poru vanga, we will eat there. The hotel charge nichom, the boarding margin cost alla, nichom, we will sleep there and we will. Next morning, we will. So immediately she turned around and said that அங்க யாருன்னு எனக்கு தெரியாது. She said, அங்க யாருன்னு எனக்கு தெரியாது. I looked at her and said, how long you know me? You know me only for 1 week. That time you knew me, we will get to know them also. For 2 minutes, she was like, then I thought, you just say, unless you can be very well, so you just fall to the Buddha. Then I got it for the next 10 years, I got it. That's a different story. You cannot understand it like that. That's what he's saying. Unmanifest in the beginning, manifest in the middle, again unmanifest in the end. But something happens in the middle part and is it completely carried away. something happens in the middle part. The moha, the delusion, something happens in the middle. What is that middle part? It has come and it will stay forever. It has come and it will stay forever. Not only it will stay forever, it will stay forever giving me more joy, more happiness. If something stays with you forever now, know that it will produce sorrow. Your grandfather is giving you happiness today. Your great grandfather is giving you happiness today because he left you. Imagine being still sitting with him. Imagine he's still sitting with you. What will happen? So, if you are really wise, you will not expect anything to stay with you. Because you have understood what happens is if anything is stuck for you, because you have understood what if you are stuck, what happens? Grief done, suffering done. How do you understand that? Just look at your own life. Just look at your own life. When Ranga, another student, met Ranjini for the first time, he said, I have seen you before. He turned around and said, where did you? She didn't remember. So for me, how did she remember? She remembered, I have seen you before. He said, where have you seen me? You were working in that office in Pimpri-lo with that MD? I was working in the office on the corner in the crowd, seeking appointment with the MD, and you refused appointment. I told her that, see, maybe we two would have traveled in the same local. I used to take the local from Malavli to Pune. She used to take the local from another station to Pune. Maybe we both would have traveled in the same compartment too. And yet, unmanifest. And yet, it didn't happen. Now something has happened, and you believe that it has to stay. Not only stay forever, it has to stay forever, giving you more joy, more happiness. The law of life is, if anything stays with you for If anything stays with you without changing, it destroys you. The food that you eat has to change the form. If it is not changing the form, sitting as food inside of you, it is poison. That's all. What is there to grieve about? So when you are getting rid of your attachment, you are only getting rid of poison. You are not doing anything extraordinary for the whole world to fall at your feet. You are just doing that. You are doing something to protect your own self. Beings are unmanifest in their beginning, manifest in their middle, unmanifest in their end. Even then, what is there for you to, even then, what is there for you to grieve about? There's no need to grieve. But grief happens because of what? Grief happens because of? Something happens in the middle part, and you are? And you are? Stuck to it. the intensity of your sorrow is dependent on the intensity of your attachment. The intensity of your sorrow is dependent upon the intensity of your attachment. More attachment, more sorrow. Less attachment, less sorrow. No attachment, no sorrow. Example, you see so many deaths every day. Does that affect you? Does that bother you? In fact, you get irritated at death. Road and they are polluting, huh? Traffic jam, sir. Why can't they quietly go? They run down the bus, crackers too, and then your car also they will bust the crackers, no? Sometimes. Huh? And you get agitated, you get irritated, you get frustrated. Supposing if that person who is dead is an acquaintance. Acquaintance means your colleague's mother-in-law, office says you have to go. So everyone from the office will come. Everyone looking at the time. Go. There it is completely. Here something. Go. Someone more close to you. What is your sorrow? The closest, what is the sorrow? Therefore, grief, the intensity of your grief is directly dependent upon the intensity of your attachment. Therefore, if you are grieving, Arjuna, understand that you are grieving because of your attachment. Arjuna is grieving now because of his attachment to his relatives, to his family. He is grieving because of that. What is the grief? They will die, no? They will die, no? Anyway, they are dead. What are you grieving about? Anyway, they are dead. Anyway, they have change. Anyway, they don't want you. What are you grieving about? You grieving about because, how can they say? All grief is because, see, you can say, I don't need you and walk out. You will not feel any grief. When someone says, I don't need you and walk out, you suffer. Have you ever observed it? So foolish is this life. When someone tells you, I don't need you, you get affected. But then you can say to somebody, I don't need you. You will have no effect. You will not have any problems at all because you have enough reason to believe that you are right. That's all. You have enough reasons to believe that you are right. Just as you have enough reasons to believe that you are right, the other also has enough reasons to believe that they are right. What are you grieving about? You grieve because of your attachment. You suffer because of your selfishness. You don't suffer because of anything else. If you suffer because of anything else, means if death can cause pain, you should be in constant pain because so many are dying, so many are suffering because of that. Attachment creates an imagination and you suffer because of that imagination. Something happens in the middle, that's imagination. Attachment is a kind of delusion, it's a kind of an imagination, and that imagination makes you to suffer. What is that imagination? A simple example I'll give you. You read in the newspaper, a newspaper report, that 3-year-old girl got raped. You read it. It might not have happened to you, but then reading that, for the rest of your life you will be educated. Why? 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 First layer. Oh my God. My daughter is also going out. Something like that can happen to her. So even if she is late by 2 minutes, I imagine what will strike me first? Like that? Ravindra. That is enough to create? Agitation, fear, anger, I don't know what all it is. And when the child enters the house, what happens? Relief along later down. First is the offload. That is first layer. Because of your imagination. What is imagination? See, things need not happen. You can imagine and suffer. That's a delusion of human being. That all sorrows because of you. You are imagining and you are suffering. Just that, somehow you can imagine that something can happen to? Something like this can happen to? No, sir. I don't suffer because of all this. It's very immoral to do that, no? That person must be shocked, no? That person must be hanged to death, no? I'm not saying you should not be shocked. I'm not saying you should be given Nobel Prize. You suffer because of what? Second layer. First layer is a direct imagination that something can happen to you. Second case is you might not think it can happen to you, but you think that you have a genuine concern for the society. Yeah. And that will cost, and that will give you enough justification to take a machine gun and shoot. End of the day, all actions, all that you do, arises out of your attachment. And this attachment creates a kind of imagination. What is imagination? Unmanifest on both sides, suddenly there is a manifestation. Unmanifest in the beginning, unmanifest in the end. When something is unmanifest in the beginning, and when something is unmanifest in the end, the manifestation that you see in the middle is only a temporary phenomena. It's only a temporary phenomena. If you can actually understand it as imagination, you become enlightened. You become another Krishna. But even if you can't understand that, at least this much you can understand. What? It's a temporary phenomena. Something by nature which is temporary, to expect it to be permanent, causes grief. By nature it is temporary and you expect it to be permanent. By nature that which is temporary, you expect it to be permanent, and that permanency causes, and this permanency causes grief. And it is so convincing also, because it is so convincing also. How it is so convincing? Because it's there right in front of your eyes, sitting as a real entity. How can you understand it as temporary? How can you understand that? Imagination. You cannot understand that. Therefore, to breathe. Even from the layman's point of view, Arjuna, if you understand, you are unmanifest in the beginning, manifest in the middle, and manifest in the end. Even there, what are you actually grieving about? Is there any reason to that? Is there any cause to grieve? Is there any reality to grieve? And yet, you grieve. And then, you grieve. Why? Don't have this knowledge. You don't have this understanding. Even if you have this knowledge and understanding, you don't put in the effort to reflect deeply to make it your own. See, here we cannot say we don't have this. Here we cannot say we don't have this knowledge, because we have enough knowledge, but we have not done enough manana. We have not done enough reflection to make it your own. Once you make it your own, you are free. Once you make it your own, you are free. Free of what? Free of shoka. Free of greed. Isallam, he calls it as layman's point of view. Eh? That way every 10 minutes I'm reminding you. Yeah, he's saying this is layman point of view, what is philosophy? You know, this looks more philosophical than Vadamsi Jivanani Yada Vihaya Naman. That looked nothing in compared to this. Or that looked very easy also. This looks very It looks so easy because you don't know anything about it. Tennis looks very easy as long as Federer is playing it. Yeah. You get onto the tennis court will look like a football field. Suddenly it becomes, at least to me it happened like this. First time when I saw, enna pa ivlo pressure irukku. 21 inch field lo you see, then the score will be only 20 inches. Yeah, you go and read it so good. And then the boy said, sir, not the problem, come. All the bones all reach to the neck only, within the cramp it. And yet I come and sit and watch in the television, it looks. So, the layman's point of view looks more difficult than philosophy. What is it? Beings are unmanifest in their origin, manifest in the beginning, and unmanifest in the end. So, between two unmanifest, there is a manifestation. Between two unmanifest, there is a manifestation. Between two unmanifestation, there is a that manifestation period can be 5 years, 50 years, doesn't matter. But the starting point of it is unmanifest. That's why I started by saying, remember this. There is a point in your life. There was a point in your life where you existed without it. You existed without it. Normally. Something happened, the sheer turn of events, it just came into existence. Why it gives such an exaggerated importance? Yes. Always remember that point, that day before you met this person, that day before this event happened. Everything was all right. But something happened in the middle. That made you to believe what? That made for Mr. Rector. After a long search, I met the person that I was looking for.
You will create your own vocabulary and blind yourself. You will create your own vocabulary and you will blind yourself. That's why whenever you want to blind yourself, you will quote poetry. Because the nature of poetry is to imagine. They only, neighbor. So we have been traveling, waiting to meet you, and we have been, and then at the right moment, it happened there. Now you are sitting and cursing. Why did that moment happen at all? Nothing would have happened then. Beings are, everything in life is unmanifest, manifest, unmanifest. As far as you, the ego, the individual is concerned, the unmanifest comes first. Then comes the manifestation. And then goes into unmanifest again. As far as you, the ego, the individual is concerned, that which comes first is the unmanifest. Because there was a time where it wasn't existing. Yourself is unmanifest at some point of time. If you have the courage, go to that extent. You yourself was unmanifest at some point of time. Yeah. Imagine a point where you are not. See, there was a point of time when we are all not born. No one was crying. No one was suffering. The whole world was not waiting for even them to be. Born, you are a holy man. Whole world must be waiting for him to avatar purusha. Everyone thinks about themselves like that. Yeah, everyone thinks about themselves like that. Nothing happened. Everything happened. Everything went on. Suddenly you came into existence. And you give such an exaggerated value to your own self. Understand it like that. Don't worry about others. Start with others in the beginning and then at some point of time, use it upon yourself. There was a time that you didn't exist. Definitely there is a time that you are not going to exist. So in between, you are unnecessarily existing. Unnecessarily as an ego is existing. And this causes grief. Because there is a period of time that you didn't exist. There is a period of time that you are not going to exist. There is a period of time that you are not going to exist. Now, you give an exaggerated value to your presence. Your existence. Not only you give having given an exaggerated value to your own presence, selflessly you will be suffering and you will be causing suffering and torturing other person. Right? You are so important, how can others not recognize your importance? That's all reasons. So the importance that you have given to yourself itself is
Itself is imaginary.
Then your existence itself is this imagination. What reality does anything else have? Even there's nothing to grieve.
Previous verse you spoke about assessment. Layman's point of view is very practical tips. Assessment. Here he is talking about another facet. Fantastic facet. What is it? Unmanifest in the beginning, manifest now, again unmanifest in the end. So between two unmanifestations, a
manifestation exists, and there is an exaggerated value given to this present, which is the manifestation. You are grieving because you have not understood the present as a temporary phenomenon. You are in grief, you are in sorrow, you are in suffering because you have not understood this phenomena as a temporary phenomenon. First understand it as temporary. Then if you have enough courage, understand it as impermanent. First you understand it as temporary, impermanent. If you have enough courage, later on you understand it as imagination. Don't directly go into imagination. It will not help you in any way. Directly saying the whole thing as imagination doesn't help you in any way. Sometimes I give this example. It's like giving a discourse to a dog about the futility of the bone. 1 hour lecture you give to the dog about the futility of the bone. After the lecture is over, first thing the dog will ask is, the 1 hour lecture la pasi konjam jaasti aayichu, where is my bone? So don't go into the highest futility. Go step by step. First thing is, understand it as temporary. Understand it as impermanent. From the permanency, understand it as impermanent. Later on, you will evolve to a little height to understand it as imagination. Then in the classroom, we cover all the steps. But for all practical purposes, don't worry about the imagination at all. Now, in the context of these verses, because he is calling it as layman, point of view, now let us try and be humble enough to stay at layman's point of view. What is the layman's point of view? It is temporary. It is impermanent. There was a point of time that it didn't exist. There is a point of time that it is not going to exist. What is it that I did in between that I got? That I got so stuck that it is causing me grief. This explains how to overcome, out of 10 situations, the assessment and these verses combined will help you 7-8 times. It will help you to temporarily. That's what I call layman's point of view. Means these two, out of 10 situations, 7-8 will, the intensity will reduce if you use these two verses as a practical tool. Again, be careful. It will again be as a temporary shelf life. After a period of time you will get used to it also. After you will get bored with it also. But it has a very practical utility till you gain enough conviction. Till you gain enough wisdom, what do you do? Use these two. Whatever he calls as a practical layman's point of view. Number one, lack assessment or no wrong assessment or no assessment. One. Number two, there was a time when it didn't exist and I was living too. Now what has happened that I believe that I can't live without it. From your own experience, from your own life, you can identify with these two. Even then, Arjuna, do not grieve. For grief belongs to ignorance. For grief belongs to imagination. And if you have to stop grieving, stop imagining. Get into the fact. What is the fact? Assessment helps you to understand the fact. Expectation goes out. If that is too much, na, at least understand there was a time when it wasn't there. Something happened in between it came. Again it's going to leave.
therefore do not greed.